Okay, today is the 9th of September 2009, and we only have about a week left for Dharma talk. I'm quite happy that we finished the Samyutta Nikaya. So I promise that we will do part of the Majjhima Nikaya. So we'll start tonight on the Majjhima Nikaya. This Majjhima Nikaya, Majjhima means middle or medium, and Nikaya means collection. So it's a collection of medium length discourses of the Buddha. Compared to, for example, the Digha Nikaya is long discourses. This one is middle length or medium length discourses. And then we finished the Samyutta Nikaya, that was all mostly short discourses. And the Samyutta Nikaya, there's over 2,000 suttas because they are short. Anguttara Nikaya also over 2,000 suttas, short suttas. But in the Majjhima Nikaya, we only have 152 suttas. And that's divided into three books. The topics are very wide range of topics. But as usual, most of the discourses were given to the monks, the Bhikkhu Sangha. So out of these 152 discourses, we start from the number one, the first discourse. And of all the discourses, the suttas in the Majjhima Nikaya, this number one is the hardest nut to crack. It's very difficult to understand. For a beginner, you just can't make head or tail out of it. Okay, this sutta is called Mulapariyaya Sutta. And here they translate as the root of all things. Mula, as we know in Bahasa Melayu, is the beginning of all things, the root of all things. This word things is not so good because it is actually Sabbadhamma, Mulapariyaya. Sabbadhamma is all dhammas. Here they say all things. But I think maybe a better translation is all states, the root of all states. And this states refers to states of mind. States of mind, because the Buddha is trying to explain how unwholesome states arise because the beginning we had some wrong conceptions. We start off on the wrong foot, And in the Magandhya Sutta, the Buddha says that we have been deceived by our mind for a long time. Lifetime after lifetime, we've been deceived by our mind. So how have we been deceived by our mind? Here it tries to explain a bit. Okay, let's go to the sutta and see. Thus have I heard, on one occasion the Blessed One was living in Ukata, in the Subhaga Grove, at the root of a royal sala tree. There he addressed the monks thus, "Monks, Venerable Sir," they replied. The Blessed One said, "Monks, I will teach you a discourse on the root of all things. Listen and attend closely to what I shall say." "Yes, Venerable Sir," the monks replied. The Blessed One said, "Hear, monks, an untaught ordinary person, Putujana, who does not see noble ones, Aryans, and is unskilled and untrained in their Dhamma, who does not see true men, and is unskilled and untrained in their Dhamma, perceives earth as earth. Having perceived earth as earth, he conceives earth. He conceives in earth. He conceives from earth. He conceives earth to be mine. He delights in earth. Why is that? Because he has not fully understood it, I say." Stop here for a moment. This he conceives, this word, the Pali word is manyati. And it comes from the root word man, M-A-N. And M-A-N means to think. So this word manyati, you can say, is to conceive, to think, to construe, to discriminate, etc. So here, an ordinary person, he perceives earth as earth. What it means is that his perception of earth is what his senses tell him. You know, we perceive the world through our six senses, through the eyes we see, through the ears we hear, the nose we smell, the tongue we taste, the body we touch, and the mind things. So, because an ordinary person, his mind is not developed, so he does not see from a higher wisdom. He only accepts what the senses tell him, what is received through the senses. He believes everything that the senses tell him. That's why he perceives earth as earth. And then having perceived earth as earth, he conceives earth. That means he thinks about earth. And then he conceives in earth. He conceives from earth. This one I will explain a little bit later. He conceives earth to be mine. He delights in earth because earth is one of the things in the world that gives him enjoyment, pleasure. So he wants to possess this earth. Wants earth to be mine because he has not fully understood it. So a major part of the sutta repeats this, almost the same thing. He perceives water as water. Having perceived water as water, he conceives water. He conceives in water. He conceives from water. He conceives water to be mine. He delights in water. Why is that? Because he has not fully understood it, I say. Similarly, he perceives fire as fire. Having perceived fire as fire, he conceives fire. He conceives in fire. He conceives from fire. He conceives fire to be mine. He delights in fire. Why is that? Because he has not fully understood it, I say. Then he perceives air as air in the same way. It repeats the sequence. And he perceives beings as beings. He perceives gods as gods. He perceives Pajapati as Pajapati. Pajapati is supposed to be the creator god. He perceives Brahma as Brahma. He perceives the gods of streaming radiance as the gods of streaming radiance. Stop it for a moment. This Brahma is the Deva in the first jhana plane. So the gods of streaming radiance are the gods in the second jhana plane. He perceives the gods of refulgent glory as the gods of refulgent glory. This is supposed to be the third jhana. He perceives the gods of great fruit, Vihapala, as the gods of great fruit. This is the fourth jhana heavens. He perceives the overlord as the overlord. He perceives the base of infinite space as the base of infinite space. He perceives the base of infinite consciousness as the base of infinite consciousness. He perceives the base of nothingness as the base of nothingness. He perceives the base of neither perception nor non-perception as the base of neither perception nor non-perception. He perceives the seen as the seen. He perceives the heard as the heard. He perceives the sensed as the sense. He perceives the cognized as the cognized. So you see these last four things, the seen, the heard, the sense, and the cognized. The cognized is what is cognized through the thinking faculty, the mind. So the sense means what is smelled, what is tasted, what is touched. So the sense refers to the three sense bases, the smelled, the tasted, and the touched. He perceives unity as unity. He perceives diversity as diversity. He perceives all as all. He perceives Nibbana as Nibbana. So all of them, they repeat the same thing. Having perceived Nibbana as Nibbana, he conceives Nibbana. He conceives in Nibbana. He conceives from Nibbana. He conceives Nibbana to be mine. He delights in Nibbana. Why is that? Because he has not fully understood it, I say. So here, what's the meaning of he conceives, then after that, he conceives in that object, and then he conceives from that object. I try to explain. First, he perceives, for example, we take an example, the first one, earth. He perceives earth as earth. He believes entirely what the senses tell him, that earth is solid, it's real and all that. Having perceived earth, he conceives earth. He thinks about earth. He construes, has some conception about earth, has some idea about earth. And then he conceives in earth. I think this means he conceives an object in earth. And then he conceives from earth, means he conceives a subject apart from earth. So this mind, whenever consciousness works, you sense an object, for example, you see or you hear. And then you have this perception that there is an object out there. And you have a subject, a self inside you. You are seeing something or you are hearing something. So this mind tends to set up this subject and object. This is the way the mind tricks us. This subject and object is just a perception. What happens is that just consciousness arises. For example, we take seeing consciousness. Seeing consciousness arises and passes away. Seeing consciousness arises and passes away. But when seeing consciousness arises, you seem to have this distinction between an object and a subject. I see that form, or hearing also. When a sound comes to the ear, hearing consciousness arises. And this hearing consciousness arises and ceases. But in the process of this consciousness arising, the mind tricks you into believing that I am hearing that sound. But in actual fact, consciousness just arises and passes away. There's no subject, there's no object. But the mind tells us that there is an I hearing that sound. There's an I smelling the smell. There's an I tasting the taste. So this is how nature tricks living beings into believing you have a self. So when we believe that there's a self, we fight for survival. Fight for survival. This world is a world of the survival of the fittest. So the Buddha says we have been tricked by the mind for a long time. So this is the beginning, the wrong footing that the mind sets us. The mind sets us on the wrong footing to make us believe that there is a self, that this I am, I exist. Remember the dependent origination, we talk about this dependent origin, bhava, the being. Being is that I exist, I am. This concept that you have. It's a wrong notion, the Buddha tells us. It's a wrong notion. There's anatta, there's no self. It's just that the mind tricks us into believing that I am self. I have attained this, I have attained that, I am great, and all this thing. So because of that bhava, that being that arises, sometimes they call it that mana, that what's the word? Mana, what's the translation of mana? The last factor to be destroyed is I forgot. It's the last factor. There are five last factors that the Arahant destroys. One is restlessness, one is ignorance, one is conceit. Conceit, that's the English word. So this conceit, this I am, is the way the mind tricks us. So once we have this wrong perception, because of this, then this is the beginning of the way the mind works, and the root of all the unwholesome states in the mind. and all the unwholesome states in the mind, greed, hatred, and delusion, all arise because of this feeling or this perception that I exist, I am, right? So here the Buddha is trying to tell us that because of this conception that there is an object out there and there is a subject inside here that we delight, we delight, and then we want to possess whatever it is that gives us delight in the world. And so the Buddha says it is because we have not fully understood it. So for all the things in the world mentioned here, the same thing happens once we go on the wrong footing. The first step is wrong, then all the rest is wrong, and wholesome states arise because of that. That's why this sutta is called the root of all states, the root of all, the beginning of all states, of all mind states. Okay. Then the Buddha says, monks, a monk who is in higher training, in higher training means a seka, an arya, whose mind has not reached the goal and who is still aspiring to the supreme security from bondage, directly knows earth as earth. Having directly known earth as earth, he should not conceive earth. He should not conceive in earth. He should not conceive from earth. He should not conceive earth to be mine. He should not delight in earth. Why is that? So that he may fully understand it, I say. Stop here for a moment. So here, an arya, either first path attainer or first fruit, second path, second fruit, third path, third fruit, or fourth path attainer. These seven types of aryans is called one in training. So because he has heard the Dhamma from the Buddha and he has understood something, the Buddha says, he knows earth as earth, he knows the real thing, but he has not fully understood it yet, so he's still in training. So he should not conceive earth, that means he should not think about earth, he should not have views about earth or things in the world, he should not think about things in the world. How do you stop thinking about things in the world? From attaining jhana, because the mind tends to proliferate, the mind tends to think a lot. Only when you attain one-pointedness of mind, when you attain jhana, the mind stops proliferating, it stops thinking so much. The Buddha says he should not conceive earth. Then he should not conceive an object in earth. He should not conceive an object in earth. And he should not conceive a subject apart from earth, a self apart from the object of earth. And so he should not conceive earth to be mine, because he knows the Dhamma to the extent that the Buddha, that he believes that the Buddha says that there is no self. So because of that, he should not conceive earth to be mine. He should not delight in earth. Why is that? So that he may fully understand it. So he is walking the path to fully understand it. So he's practicing the path to liberation. So the Buddha says that he should not conceive the objects in the world. He should not conceive an object in the things in the world. He should not conceive a subject, a self, apart from the things in the world, and he should not delight in the things in the world. When he does not delight in the things in the world, then he does not want to possess them, to want them to be mine. Similarly, he knows water as water, fire, etc. So for all the other objects mentioned before, up to Nibbana. And then the Buddha says, monks, a monk who is an arahant with asavas destroyed, who has lived the holy life, done what had to be done, laid down the burden, reached the true goal, destroyed the fetters of being, and is completely liberated through final knowledge, directly knows earth as earth. Having directly known earth as earth, he does not conceive earth. He does not conceive an object in earth. He does not conceive a subject apart from earth. He does not conceive earth to be mine. He does not delight in earth. Why is that? Because he has fully understood it, I say. And similarly for the other objects mentioned before. So an arahanna is one with asavas destroyed. What is this asavas destroyed? Asavas literally means outflows. Something that flows. Outflows. And in this case, it means uncontrolled mental outflows. An ordinary person or a being who is not yet liberated from samsara, the mind tends to flow without control. And that is basically the flow of consciousness. And when consciousness flows without control, and the world arises, because the world is only exists inside consciousness. If there's no consciousness, there's no world. In other words, the world is, in a sense, a bit like a dream. So only when consciousness flows, that there is world. When there's no consciousness, there's no world. So an arahant has destroyed the uncontrolled mental outflows, so that when he dies, the consciousness stops flowing. So that the samsara has stopped for him. So an arahant is liberated, and he directly knows earth as earth. Having directly known earth as earth, he does not conceive earth. He does not conceive an object in earth. He does not conceive a subject apart from earth. He does not conceive earth to be mine. He does not delight in earth. And why? Because he has fully understood it. Similarly, monks, a monk who is an arahant, completely liberated to final knowledge, directly knows earth as earth. Having directly known earth as earth, he does not conceive earth. He does not conceive an object in earth. He does not conceive a subject apart from earth. He does not conceive earth to be mine. He does not delight in earth. Why is that? Because he is free from lust through the destruction of lust. So this is another characteristic of an arahant, a liberated being. The first part there says he has fully understood, an arahant has fully understood. And here it says an arahant is free from lust through the destruction of lust. So similarly, the next paragraph the Buddha says, a monk who is an arahant, completely liberated, directly knows earth as earth. Having directly known earth as earth, he does not conceive earth. He does not conceive an object in earth. He does not conceive a subject apart from earth. He does not conceive earth to be mine. He does not delight in earth. Why is that? Because he is free from hatred through the destruction of hatred. And the next part is almost the same. An arahant, completely liberated, directly knows earth as earth, etc. And he does not conceive earth to be mine. He does not delight in earth. Why is that? Because he's free from delusion through the destruction of delusion. And then the Buddha says, monks, the Tathagata, accomplished and fully enlightened, Sammasambuddha, directly knows earth as earth. Having directly known earth as earth, he does not conceive earth. He does not conceive an object in earth. He does not conceive a subject apart from earth. He does not conceive earth to be mine. He does not delight in earth. Why is that? Because the Tathagata has fully understood it to the end, I say. So similarly for the other objects. And then the next paragraph, monks, the Tathagata, arahant, Sammasambuddha, directly knows earth as earth. Having directly known earth as earth, he does not conceive earth. He does not conceive an object in earth. He does not conceive a subject apart from earth. He does not conceive earth to be mine. He does not delight in earth. Why is that? Because he has understood that delight is the root of suffering, and that with being as condition, there is birth, and that for whatever has come to be, there is aging and death. Therefore, monks, through the complete destruction, fading away, cessation, giving up and relinquishing of cravings, the Tathagata has awakened to supreme enlightenment, I say. Similarly, he directly knows water as water, Nibbana as Nibbana, etc. This is what the Blessed One said. But those monks did not delight in the Blessed One's words. So this last part, the Buddha says, the Buddha has understood that delight is the root of suffering. If you want to enjoy life, that is the cause of suffering. And with being as condition, there is birth. This being is that conceit, I am. Once you have this perception that I am or I exist, then you will see yourself born in the world. And whatever has come to be, whatever has a self, I am, there is aging and death, because this world is impermanent. When you see yourself in the world, then you see yourself aging, becoming sick and dying. So through the complete destruction, fading away, cessation, giving up and relinquishing of cravings, the Tathagata has awakened to supreme full enlightenment. So the only way to become enlightened is to give up all that craving, all the craving for all the enjoyable things in the world. And then the last sentence says that the monks did not delight in the Blessed One's words. This is one of the few suttas where the monks could not accept. Well, definitely those monks are not arahants, not even Aryans. I guess it does not refer to all the monks, probably some of the monks did not accept the Buddha's words here, because the words here are very deep and profound. So some of them, when they listen to it, they cannot understand, firstly. Secondly, a lot of people, they cannot give up the self. Cannot give up the self, because it is the self. With the self, you want to enjoy. Without the self, where there's no enjoyment. So that's the sutta. I may not have explained it fully, but at least hopefully it gives you a little idea about this, what the Buddha is trying to teach here. In the initial stages, when I read through this sutta so many times, I couldn't understand it. The next sutta is Sabbasava Sutta. Actually, Sabbasava means Sabba Asavala. All the asavas, here it says all the taints. Taints is a translation for asavas. To me, asava means uncontrolled mental outflows. You can also call it defilements. Majjhima Nikaya Sutta number 2. Thus have I heard. On one occasion, the Blessed One was living at Savati in Jeta's Grove, Anatha Pindika's park. There he addressed the monks thus, "Monks, Venerable Sir," they replied. The Blessed One said, "Monks, I will teach you a discourse on the restraint of all the taints, restraint of the asavas. Listen and attend closely to what I shall say." "Yes, Venerable Sir," the monks replied. The Blessed One said, "Monks, I say that the destruction of the asavas is for one who knows and sees, not for one who does not know and see." Who knows and sees what? Wise attention and unwise attention. The translation is careful attention and careless attention. When one attends carelessly, unarisen asavas arise and arisen asavas increase. When one attends carefully or wisely, unarisen asavas do not arise and arisen asavas are abandoned. Monks, there are asavas that should be abandoned by seeing. There are asavas or taints that should be abandoned by restraining. There are asavas that should be abandoned by using. There are asavas that should be abandoned by enduring. There are asavas that should be abandoned by avoiding. There are asavas that should be abandoned by removing. There are asavas that should be abandoned by developing. Stop here for a moment. So from here, this what the Buddha says, that the asava should be abandoned by various ways, seeing, restraining and all that. So here, what the Buddha is trying to say is that asavas here refers to the defilements. The defilements should be abandoned by various ways. Seeing, restraining, using, enduring, avoiding, removing, developing. What asavas, monks, should be abandoned by seeing? Here, monks, an untaught, ordinary worldling who does not see Aryans, noble ones, and is unskilled and untrained in the Dhamma, who does not see true men, and is unskilled and untrained in the Dhamma, does not understand what things are fit for attention and what things are unfit for attention. Since that is so, he attends to those things unfit for attention, and he does not attend to those things fit for attention. What are the things unfit for attention that he attends to? They are things such that when he attends to them, the unarisen asava of sensual desire arises in him, and the arisen asava of sensual desire increases. The unarisen asava of being arises in him, and the arisen asava of being increases. The unarisen asava of ignorance arises in him, and the arisen asava of ignorance increases. These are the things unfit for attention that he attends to. So here, from here you can see that in this sutta, the asavas refers to the defilement of sensual desire, the defilement of being, bhava, a being, or that I am, and the asava, or defilement of ignorance. Sometimes in the suttas, the Buddha mentions four things. When he talks about asava, here he mentions three things. Sometimes one more added is views, having a lot of views. And what are the things fit for attention that he does not attend to? They are things such that when he attends to them, the unarisen asava of sensual desire does not arise in him, and the arisen asava of sensual desire is abandoned. The unarisen asava of being does not arise in him, and the arisen asava of being is abandoned. The unarisen asava of ignorance does not arise in him, and the arisen asava of ignorance is abandoned. These are the things fit for attention that he does not attend to. By attending to things unfit for attention, and by not attending to things fit, by attending to things unfit for attention, and by attending to things fit for attention, both unarisen asavas arise in him, and arisen asavas increase. This is how he attends unwisely or carelessly. Was I in the past? Was I not in the past? What was I in the past? How was I in the past? Having been what did I become in the past? Shall I be in the future? Shall I not be in the future? Which reminds me, a lot of people like to know who they were in their previous life, right? So the Buddha says all this is paying careless attention. What shall I be in the future? How shall I be in the future? Having been what shall I become in the future? Or else he is inwardly perplexed about the present. Thus, am I? Am I not? In other words, do I exist? Do I not exist? What am I? How am I? Where has this being come from? Where will it go? When he attends unwisely in this way, one of six views arises in him. The view, self exists for me, arises in him as true and established. Or the view, no self exists for me, arises in him as true and established. Or the view, I perceive self with self, arises in him as true and established. Or the view, I perceive not self with self, arises in him as true and established. Or the view, I perceive self with the not self, arises in him as true and established. or else he has some such view as this. It is this self of mind that speaks and feels and experiences here and there the result of good and bad karma actions. But this self of mind is permanent, everlasting, eternal, not subject to change, and it will endure as long as eternity. This speculative view, monks, is called the thicket of views, the wilderness of views, the contortion of views, the vacillation of views, the fetter of views. Fettered by the fetter of views, the untaught ordinary worldling is not free from birth, aging and death, from sorrow, lamentation, pain, grief and despair. He is not freed from suffering, I say. Monks, a well-taught, noble disciple who sees noble ones and is skilled and trained in their Dhamma, who sees true men and is skilled and trained in their Dhamma, understands what things are fit for attention and what things are unfit for attention. Since that is so, he does not attend to those things unfit for attention, and he attends to those things fit for attention. And what are the things unfit for attention that he does not attend to? They are things such that when he attends to them, the unarisen asava of sensual desire arises in him, and the arisen asava of ignorance increases, etc. These are the things unfit for attention that he does not attend to. And what are the things fit for attention that he attends to? They are the things such that when he attends to them, the unarisen asava of sensual desire of being and of ignorance does not arise in him, and the arisen asavas are abandoned. These are the things fit for attention that he attends to. By not attending to things unfit for attention, and by attending to things fit for attention, unarisen asavas do not arise, and arisen asavas are abandoned. He attends wisely or carefully. This is suffering. He attends wisely. This is the origin of suffering. This is the cessation of suffering. This is the way leading to the cessation of suffering. When he attends wisely in this way, three factors are abandoned in him: identity view, doubt, and adherence to rules and observances. These are called the asavas that should be abandoned by seeing. Stop here for a moment. So here the Buddha is saying, noble disciple, when he pays attention and investigates the four noble truths, and he understands them, the three factors, identity view, doubt, and adherence to rules and observances, are abandoned in him, so that he becomes a sotapanna, first fruit, arya. What asavas, monks, should be abandoned by restraining? Stop here for a moment. So just now what the Buddha was saying, there are certain things that we should not pay attention to in the world. And there are certain things that we should pay attention to in the world. Those things that we should not pay attention to are those that have nothing to do with the Dhamma. Those that have to do with the Buddha's Dhamma are the things that we should pay attention to, especially the Four Noble Truths. What asavas, monks, should be abandoned by restraining? Here a monk, reflecting wisely, abides with the eye faculty restrained, while asavas, vexation and fever might arise in one who abides with the eye faculty unrestrained. There are no asavas, vexation or fever in one who abides with the eye faculty restrained. Reflecting wisely, he abides with the ear faculty restrained, with the nose faculty, tongue faculty, body faculty and mind faculty restrained. While asavas, vexation and fever might arise in one who abides with the faculties unrestrained, there are no asavas, vexation or fever in one who abides with the faculties restrained. These are called the asavas that should be abandoned by restraining. So the second one, the Buddha is saying that we should keep a guard at our six sense doors. Those things that are not proper for us to pay attention to at the six sense doors, we don't pay attention tula, like the sight, sound, smell, taste, touch, and thoughts. Because if we paid attention to these unbeneficial sense objects, then the asavas or defilements would arise. Then number three, what asavas, monks, should be abandoned by using? Here a monk, reflecting wisely, uses the robe only for protection from cold, for protection from heat, for protection from contact with gadflies, mosquitoes, wind, sun, and creeping things, and only for the purpose of concealing the private parts. Reflecting wisely, he uses alms food, neither for amusement nor for intoxication, nor for the sake of physical beauty and attractiveness, but only for the endurance and continuance of this body, for ending discomfort, and for assisting the holy life. Considering, thus I shall terminate old feelings of hunger without arousing new feelings of greed, and I shall be healthy, blameless, and live in comfort. Reflecting wisely, he uses the resting place only for protection from cold, for protection from heat, for protection from contact with gadflies, mosquitoes, wind, sun, and creeping things, and only for the purpose of warding off the perils of climate and for enjoying retreat. Reflecting wisely, he uses the medicinal requisites only for protection from arisen, afflicting feelings and for the benefit of good health. While asavas, vexation, and fever might arise in one who does not use the requisites thus, there are no asavas, vexation, or fever in one who uses them thus. These are called the asavas that should be abandoned by using. Stop here for a while. So here, we use the requisites in a wise way, without being greedy for them, knowing that they only help us so that we can continue to practice the ritual path. If you remember, when we do the chants, we often do this chant, Patisan ka yo ni so chivarang patiseva mi. So these are the four chants we did. Then number four, what asavas, monks, should be abandoned by enduring? Here a monk, reflecting wisely, bears cold and heat, hunger and thirst, and contact with gadflies, mosquitoes, wind, the sun, and creeping things. He endures ill-spoken, unwelcome words, and arisen bodily feelings that are painful, racking, sharp, piercing, disagreeable, distressing, and menacing to life. While asavas, vexation, and fever might arise in one who does not endure such things, there are no asavas, vexation, or fever in one who endures them. These are called the asavas that should be abandoned by enduring. Stop here for a moment. So, when someone practices the holy path, then unpleasant feelings arise. We should practice patience, forbearance. And if we have the patience and forbearance, and then small problems become big. Big problems become small problems. Small problems become no problems. So that's how we should deal. If we can endure them, we endure. Number five, what asavas, monk, should be abandoned by avoiding? Here a monk, reflecting wisely, avoids a wild elephant, a wild horse, a wild bull, a wild dog, a snake, a stump, a bramble, patch, a chasm, a cliff, a cesspit, a sower. Reflecting wisely, he avoids sitting on unsuitable seats, wandering to unsuitable resorts or places, and associating with bad friends. Since if he were to do so, wise companions in the holy life might suspect him of evil conduct. While asavas, vexation, and fever might arise in one who does not avoid these things, there are no asavas, vexation, and fever in one who avoids them. These are called the asavas that should be abandoned by avoiding. So this one, we know certain places are not conducive for the spiritual practice. We avoid them, don't go near them. For example, if you want to walk the spiritual path and you're a lay person, and then you don't go near those jolly kakis because they will say, well, formerly our lai used to go to a karaoke and now he doesn't want to go anymore, something wrong with him. So avoid those type of friends. And then you mix with friends who are interested in the spiritual path. If you want to practice also, you don't go and find certain places which are unsuitable. In fact, a place like a cemetery is not recommended by the Buddha. The Buddha says a cemetery is a place with a lot of spirits, unclean spirits, and many of them are crying all the time, so they are very disturbed. So you go to a place, the vibes are no good, not a suitable place. Go to a place which is very peaceful, and there are no snakes and no wild elephants and other animals to disturb you. In fact, during the Buddha's time, if you look in the Sutta sometimes, even though some of the monks, they stay in the forest, but actually they stay in a kuti in the forest, They stay in a kuti in the forest. These kutis are built for them to practice. So a lot of people, they don't understand. You have a kuti to practice, you want to go out and sit under the tree. In the Buddha's days, sometimes you look at the suttas like the Maratajanya Sutta. The Mahamoggallana, he was staying in the forest, but he was staying inside a kuti. And then this Mara came to him, into his stomach. So kutis are built for us to practice in the forest. There's no point to go out of the kuti and stay under the tree. If you want to stay under the tree, there's no need for the kuti. Because the kuti is built to provide the most conducive environment for you to practice. If you stay in a kuti with the mosquito netting, there's no mosquitoes. There's no snakes to come and crawl to you. Because I've stayed in the forest before, and sometimes we stay in the open air, and you put your mosquito net, and you put it under your plastic sheet, sometimes the snake comes. Things are trying to enter. I've had this experience. And sometimes you go and set up your mosquito net, your sleeping place, in a place you didn't know there's an ant nest underneath. In the middle of the night, the ants crawl all over you. You have to start moving. So our kutis are very ideal. No need to look for a better place. What asavas monks should be abandoned by removing? Here a monk, reflecting wisely, does not tolerate an arisen thought of sensual desire. He abandons it, removes it, does away with it, and annihilates it. He does not tolerate an arisen thought of ill will. He does not tolerate an arisen thought of cruelty. He does not tolerate arisen evil and unwholesome states. He abandons them, removes them, does away with them, and annihilates them. While asavas, vexation and fever might arise in one who does not remove those thoughts, there are no asavas, vexation or fever in one who removes them. These are called the asavas that should be abandoned by removing. So here the Buddha says that we should remove unwholesome states of mind, unwholesome thoughts, don't tolerate them. What asavas monk should be abandoned by developing? Here a monk, reflecting wisely, develops the mindfulness or the recollection enlightenment factor, which is supported by seclusion, dispassion and cessation, and ripens in relinquishment. He develops the investigation of Dhamma, enlightenment factor, the energy enlightenment factor, the delight enlightenment factor, the tranquility enlightenment factor, the concentration enlightenment factor, the equanimity enlightenment factor, which is supported by seclusion, dispassion and cessation, and ripens in relinquishment. While asavas, vexation and fever might arise in one who does not develop these enlightenment factors, there are no asavas, vexation or fever in one who develops them. These are called the asavas that should be abandoned by developing. to this last partner, and we practice the bhujangas, the factors of enlightenment, in the process we develop our mind, and our mind becomes more developed, then either the asavas, these defilements arise less often, or if they do arise, then we know how to deal with them. Monks, when for a monk the asavas that should be abandoned by seeing have been abandoned by seeing, when the asavas that should be abandoned by restraining have been abandoned by restraining, when the asavas that should be abandoned by using have been abandoned by using, when the asavas that should be abandoned by enduring have been abandoned by enduring, when the asavas that should be abandoned by avoiding have been abandoned by avoiding, when the asavas that should be abandoned by removing have been abandoned by removing, when the asavas that should be abandoned by developing have been abandoned by developing, then he is called a monk who dwells restrained with the restraint of all the asavas. He has severed craving, flung off the fetters, and with the complete penetration of conceit, he has made an end of suffering. This is what the Blessed One said. The monks were satisfied and delighted in the Blessed One's words. That's the end of the sutta. So this sutta is telling us how to deal with unwholesome states of mind, defilements, and sometimes called asavas, that arise within us. So that's why I always say that the Buddha's discourses are very practical instructions. They're not all just plain theory. They're very useful. It's not like some of the later teachings, like some of the Mahayana sutras. They like to praise the Bodhisattva and all that, and talk very highly, but it's very difficult to put them into practice. Whereas the Buddha's original discourses are very practical. They give step by step instructions on what to do. So if you have the book later, you study the sutta again, then you will know when you have defilements, when defilements arise, how you should deal with them. So to recapitulate, one is by seeing clearly. Seeing clearly means paying attention to the things that you should pay attention to, and not to pay attention to those things that should be avoided. Then another one is by restraining your sixth sense faculties, not to see too much, not to hear too much, smell too much, etc. And then the asavas to be abandoned by using the requisites to get rid of uncomfortable feelings. If you don't have enough of the requisites, then you will have a lot of disturbance. Then asavas to be abandoned by enduring. Sometimes uncomfortable feelings arise, sickness and all this, and there's nothing we can do except to endure it. And then asavas should to be abandoned by avoiding, a place that is not suitable for you, avoiding associates or friends who are not suitable for you, not suitable for your cultivation of the holy life and all that. And then asavas to be abandoned by removing unwholesome states of mind that arise. For this we have to constantly look into our mind. And then by developing our mind, we practice what is taught by the Buddha and the Noble Eightfold Path, keeping sila, samadhi and panya, studying the suttas. So In that way, we develop our mind and we can handle the asavas much better. So, I think I'll stop here for today. Anything to discuss? Vexation means something that vexes you, annoys you, disturbs you. Fever means the mind is so disturbed, is so agitated. It's very, very, very agitated. Firstly, you need to see clearly. A lot of people, the mind is not developed. So when anger arises, they cannot see clearly because the hindrances are very strong. So if you practice a spiritual path, we meditate to clear the mind, clear the mind of the hindrances. So, this to remove the ill will, unless you have a developed mind, it's very difficult. If your mind is strong, then you know, the Buddha says, ill will will lead to a lot of unhappy consequences. So, seeing clearly, immediately, your mind is just... stops there, but if your mind is not strong enough, you cannot stop there. You cannot see clearly, you cannot stop all this. That's why you need to develop the mind, otherwise it's difficult to practice. You should know. You don't have to ask me. You know it for yourself.
Yeah, that's why I'm asking for any difficult things to stop it. Sometimes we know it. We are angry, it's an ill will, but it's just that we cannot stop it, the mind will continue.
It's not only this problem. It's also this, like for example, mindfulness meditation. Nowadays, all the vipassana meditations have to do with mindfulness. But mindfulness by itself is not enough. When unwholesome states arise, then you know, but you have no control over your mind. That's why the Buddha says this right concentration is the four jhanas. When your mind is strong, then anything you know that you should do, immediately you have strength of mind to do it. But if you don't have that strength of mind, you are mindful, you know, and yet the spirit is willing but the flesh is weak.
One more question. This one, Kapanti was mentioning that the Buddha advised the monks to avoid the cemetery communication. I'm reading the book on the forest, Kai Forest Monk, and there seems to have an opportunity of the flights to go to the cemetery there. What is the
A monk can go to the cemetery if he wants to contemplate on the corpse. Because sometimes there may be a corpse there for him to contemplate. But generally, I remember reading somewhere the Buddha says, cemetery is an unclean place. A lot of wailing spirits and all that, crying spirits and all that. So you go there, I don't think it's a suitable place. The vibes are no good. When we say avijja, ignorance, generally it means ignorance of the Dhamma, ignorance of the Four Noble Truths. When you study the Dhamma, you start to chip away this ignorance. As you know more and more Dhamma, your knowledge increases and your ignorance decreases. But then, if like in the beginning, even though you studied the suttas, if you have not developed the jhanas, then your mind is still has a lot of greed, hatred and delusion. The greed, hatred and delusion can only reduce if you have a very focused mind. Will reduce the greed, hatred and delusion. And then when you reduce the greed, hatred and delusion together with the knowledge of the Dhamma, in other words, samatha is the meditation that reduces your defilements of greed, hatred and delusion. And then vipassana is that contemplation of the Dhamma, hearing of the Dhamma, that gives you the knowledge. The combination of the two will totally eliminate your greed, hatred and delusion. So it is because of ignorance that you have greed, hatred and delusion. And this delusion is not seeing things as they really are. And delusion, the Buddha says, is something that is very difficult to eliminate. Because when you are deluded, you don't know that you are deluded. So for example, somebody who studies the Dhamma, if his mind is full of defilements, say like he doesn't meditate, then he may be deluded that by studying the suttas that he already has some attainment, then he start using the suttas to criticize other people, but he doesn't see his own faults because he's deluded. So you have to the theory itself is not enough. You have to meditate to get rid of the defilements. So the avijja, ignorance, is the lack of Dhamma knowledge. But the delusion is something personal, that individual. Because the Buddha says to see things as they really are, yatta bhuta jnana dasana, you need a concentrated mind. So if a monk does not have a concentrated mind, he cannot see the contradictions between the sutta and the abhidhamma and the sutta and the commentaries and the Nikayas and the later books and all these things, cannot see clearly.
Then it is our own delusion that leads us
The delusion is due to the undeveloped mind. Undeveloped mind. So it's deluded. So all that studying of the books and all that doesn't clear away his defilements, doesn't get rid of the delusion. So he needs to meditate and attain one-pointedness of mind. Okay, shall we stop here?